Greetings, everyone, and welcome back to another episode of Game Sharks. I am one of your hosts, Jimmy Good, a.k.a. the Mako Shark, and joining me, as always, is my co-host, the Great White Shark, Mr. Cory Lang. Cory, how you doing?
Just keeps snowing, Jimmy. It just never ends. It's just like this endless nightmare loop of snow and cold, but we'll prevail. We'll come through to the other side hopefully soon. So it is March after all, and happy St. Patrick's Day.
Happy St. Patrick's Day. I'm wearing a little green. I was telling Cory I've been working out. As you guys can, if you're watching, you can see this. I'm hulking out a smidge. I don't want to get pinched. But Cory, you're just like the Great White Shark in the Great White North, man. That's you. You're just trying to make it through. You know, the roads and all that stuff. So yeah. Thankfully,
I was just gonna say, I used to love the snow, and the older I get, the more impatient I become with the nature of the snow and the cold, but that's okay. We'll get through it.
Thankfully you guys aren't getting as much. I've seen some here in California, like up in like Lake Tahoe area, where it's like they're getting buried, like their homes are getting buried in snow. Like, right. Like, oh my gosh. I'm like, ugh.
Yeah, I saw some images online, and that's crazy. That's a lot of snow. That's a lot of snow.
You could tell that even though I'm out here in California, I'm still a Minnesotan at heart, because we have to talk about the weather. Like, I need to talk to you about it a little bit. But today, as always, we're not going to talk just about meteorology. We're going to talk about video gameology. I don't know if that's a science, but it probably should be. And today we're going to start off talking about the games we're most anticipated for here in 2023. The thing is, Cory, as we've done plenty of times before, we kind of talk about this earlier in the year, and then like later in the year, we talk about it again, because most of them either got pushed back or something happened. So here's hoping these games still come out in 2023.
Yeah.
I want to start with the game that you said before we even started today that you were most excited about, which is a game that many of us have played before, but maybe not in this way. Following suit with Dead Space Remake, we're talking about Resident Evil 4 Remake. Cory, why should anybody be excited about a game that came out on the GameCube? Who's excited about that, you know?
Yeah, and it's funny because this game comes out next week, so our timing is bad, but that's okay. We'll circle back next month and we'll follow up with our concluded thoughts. How about that? Let's start with our anticipated thoughts, which is totally fine. Yeah, so I think that, I mean, is that maybe the most ported game ever, Resident Evil 4?
Besides and that's
next
Skyrim.
To Skyrim. Yeah. That's kind of a joke, right? It's the ongoing joke.
Yeah.
But yeah, totally. I think 2004? I should have had this pulled up, but 2004, 2005-ish. GameCube, Nintendo platform, this hyper-violent kind of revolutionary, over-the-shoulder survival horror game. Kind of changed things up for the franchise, right?
Yeah, totally.
Kind of switching from those kind of goofy tank controls of those early PS1 games to this kind of more action-focused, over-the-shoulder kind of survival horror game. So, yeah, I would put that like in my top 10 probably ever. It's just a game I revisit constantly. We joked earlier that they literally ported it to like microwaves across the country. So
yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. Anything you have, you can run it. But it's just a fun game. And I think they have a great track record with their recent sort of remakes, right? With the Resident Evil 2 remake and the Resident Evil 3 remake. And now they're doing 4. And I would have to assume they're going to stop here, right? I think,
maybe.
I mean, I don't even know if they really needed to do 4, to be honest. I think that game still holds up fairly well, but they did put out a demo recently. Did you try it at all?
I did not try the demo. I just played through 4 for the first time ever kind of recently, so that's still fresh in my memory. I'm just curious to see how they take a lot of those kind of wacky, goofy aspects and make them a little more serious, maybe?
Right. Yeah, I've heard some, just like one example. So like the chainsaw demo that they just put out in the original game, you would have to run and survive from the chainsaw man. And basically the only way to take him down is with ammunition, right? So now I heard like just as one example of the way they've evolved this remake is you can destroy environments that'll collapse and sort of wipe enemies out, which is a really cool addition, right?
That's cool.
So I think that's just one example of the way that they're going to evolve this, you know, this classic game into 2023. And they did some of that stuff like in the Resident Evil 2 remake, and I would just expect them to just kind of push that stuff further.
Sure.
So I think it's much more than just a visual overhaul. From what I understand, they're tweaking the story a little bit. They're tweaking the environments a little bit, but at the same time, staying the course, right? So they don't alienate or offend that original game or the fans, right? So
Of course.
I probably should have did my homework and tried the demo, but I told myself I just didn't need to literally take up hard drive space on a game that I know I'm going to buy. So
yeah.
Classic game. Can't wait. Remake's coming out next Friday. I believe it's the 24th. I believe that's correct. Okay,
cool.
24th, nice. 20th. Is this a game you're looking forward to? Are you going to play this at all?
I have a healthy respect, Corey, for these remakes because they're not just remasters. So they're making it back from the ground up, supposedly. I don't know. I have this weird thing with Resident Evil. I respect it a lot because obviously it is a genre-defining franchise and also probably led to the creation of my beloved Gears of War. So in that respect, I appreciate it. However, I don't know if I'd go play this. It's one of those things like I watched a Resident Evil 2 remake, like a friend play through that, and he did a review on my channel for it a long time ago, so I get to watch a bunch of footage. I'm like, this seems cool. But one thing I absolutely abhor in a game like this, in a horror game, I hate the little puzzle things. And little two was worse, boxes. I think. Four is maybe not as bad. Four is way more action oriented. And I love Leon. Leon Kennedy's cool. I really like him, like the whole hasta luego, and he blows stuff up. Yeah, so I don't know. I'm just excited for the fans of it. My thought is I'm hoping after they get kind of this remake stuff out of their system, and I think there's a chance they might do 5. We'll see. I'm not sure. But then maybe we'll get back, like, not only where Resident Evil 7, 8, and probably 9 will go, but then making a new third-person Resident Evil. That would be interesting to me because I want to see what they've learned from all these things and kind of move forward with the franchise, because it's great to look back, don't get me wrong, but I want to see where they can go. So that to me is the most exciting part about it.
Yeah, totally. That you make an excellent point about just making a new game, right? And they are making new games, but it seems like they're kind of in that first person trend now with 7 and 8. Those are more first person games, and I think they patched in like a third person over the shoulder mode for the people that love that style. And the interesting thing that you brought up about making a new game is now fans, like with this Dead Space remake, they're like, okay, you have the tech now, why don't you just make a new game, right?
Yeah.
Rather than remaking these old ones. And I love that Dead Space remake, which we talked about last episode. But yeah, and I think, again, from a value, like you brought up that you're going to pass this one. I totally don't blame you because games are $70 now, and you gotta pick your battles, right? And and I think we'll get into some other games coming up this year, but I think it's a testament to how many amazing games are coming this year that I picked Resident Evil 4 in the same year that we're getting a Breath of the Wild sequel. So
I know.
It's just a testament to my excitement and my love for that original game. And I can't wait to play this Resident Evil 4 remake.
Yeah, totally. Well, I was thinking about something else too. The DLC for Resident Evil 8 was Rose, and it was third person, I think, if I'm not mistaken. So maybe they're kind of dabbling and they're kind of thinking about where they want to go in the future. I doubt 9 would be full third person. Maybe they would have the ability to toggle, but as we've learned, especially from the Star Wars Battlefront games from EA, that if it comes to third person or first person in a shooter, first person might be more competitive, but third person gives you way more advantages, especially with like corners and stuff in like a horror game where you're like, I can peek around a corner without peeking around a corner. So I don't know. It's interesting. But Capcom, you're doing great. Corey, this ties really well into the game that I'm excited about that they have not announced, but Capcom said they're expecting to have like one of their greatest years ever. All right. And this is a game we didn't even talk about before the show, but I wanted to bring it up. Because I've been playing a little Monster Hunter Rise, or I have in the past. Monster Hunter World 2, or whatever that's going to be. I think it's coming this year, maybe. Or that's what they're planning. Because besides Resident Evil 4, which will sell like hotcakes, I think that would be the other game that would be like, okay, this is taking them over the top. And that, for me, if it does come out this year, might be the game that like I don't question paying the $70 for. I might like at the base price, those games should probably be more because there's so much in it. Like there's just
careful so what much. You say.
I know that's true.
Todd Howard's listening. He's gonna charge $100 for Starfield now.
That's okay. I'll play it on Game Pass or whatever. No. I don't know. It's just I'm really excited. Capcom I think has been doing a great job, not only with Resident Evil Monster Hunter, but Devil May Cry. So when they're coming out with RE4 remake and then the sex Monster Hunter stuff, like it's such a cool company. And it's one of those things that like for a while there, when all the like Xbox and PlayStation were kind of gobbling up other smaller companies, I really hope Capcom never gets bought up, because I love everybody being able to play these games because they're such a high quality and they seem like one of the developers out there that like anytime something comes out for them, typically nowadays, like the big stuff, it's really good. It's really good. So I have no question RE4 will be wonderful and Monster Hunter World 2 will also be wonderful. So if Monster Hunter World 2 doesn't come out this year, then the other game, like there are some other games I do want to talk about, but you brought it up. We do have to talk about it. Breath of the Wild 2, Tears of the Kingdom. What if they called it that? I could see Nintendo calling it Legend of Zelda, Breath of the Wild 2, Tears of the Kingdom. But that game will be, that might be the biggest game potentially of the year, maybe. You know, and we've been waiting for this for a while. We thought it was coming out last like November, and then it was like last maybe spring. Hopefully they said this spring. There's a date. I just never believe the dates anymore, Corey. I keep getting burned. I'm like, but yeah, so you're excited about that one too, right?
I am. We talked about this last time and where I'm at in my life and just the overall puzzle design of the Zelda games. And I just, after playing God of War Ragnarok, I suffered from extreme puzzle fatigue. And I'm really excited for this game. You know, we got that OLED Switch recently. And this will be a TV game for sure. I'll dock my Switch. I'll see how it looks, but I'm also really excited to just lounge on the couch on that new OLED and just, lust at the visual, beauty of that game. And I hope they've learned a little bit from Elden Ring, and I not to rehash our conversation from our last episode, but I just hope there's more of an emphasis on exploration, combat, and discovery, and I hope that weapon breaking system they have. Jimmy's shaking his head.
Yeah, the degradation that hurt me.
Yes, that just grew really tiresome, and so I'm cautiously optimistic. I don't think my stand on this game has really changed since the last time we talked, but I'm very excited to see what that thing is, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, me too.
How about you?
I'm so curious because a lot of people, there's like this kind of strange comparison that after Ocarina of Time came out, they did Majora's Mask like 9 months later. They utilized like a lot of the same things, but they did it quickly. Mm-hmm. And while this game is doing similar things in that they're using a lot of the same assets, it looks like they're building upon it in such a big way, especially with the whole, like, there's a world above you. It feels kind of Skyward Sword-esque, mm-hmm. a little, maybe. Mm-hmm. And that's interesting to me. Plus more traversal mechanics, hopefully more physics-based stuff. Mm-hmm. Like, that to me, I'm okay doing puzzles, Corey, when it's like, I have to figure out a physics-based thing. When it's you need to get like the key that unlocks the chest that opens up the statue with the bust, like, you know, that drives me nuts. That's just a personal gripe. But I completely agree with you about the weapon degradation.
Yep.
That just needs to it needs to go, or it needs to be way less, because it was like, here's a cool new flame greatsword. You're going to swing it like 10 times and it's going to break. And it's like, great. And on top of that, I want the combat to be better because a lot of it felt not that great. It felt like you're just kind of slapping the lizards or whatever, like kind of pieces of metal, like you're just like dong dong, like I didn't feel that great. So I'm really hopeful that you're right, that they've taken some cues from Elden Ring, and obviously not every game is going to be that way, but
for sure,
like, one of the things I thought when they pushed all this stuff back was like, okay, Elden Ring did really well, let's give it its space, but also what did it do that people really resonated with,
right?
So that's what I'm hoping for as well. And I know you weren't as big a fan of the little shrines that were all around. Mm-hmm. I think they're still going to have that to some degree in this, but also they'll have your legacy dungeons, so They'll have the boomerang is in a dungeon and you got to use the boomerang to get through the dungeon, I'm sure it will be, or something like that.
Yeah.
So I'm excited for that one. I'm interested and it'll make me dust off my Switch.
Yeah, you brought up the traversal. One thing that looks cool in the trailer is it showed Link like on some sort of like vehicle, almost like some little truck tank looking flatbed thing.
Oh, and yeah.
My thought that is you build those in the game, I would assume. So maybe there's like some Banjo-Kazooie nuts and bolts.
I was just thinking that.
Kind of angle. Yeah. And I'm not the first to bring that up, obviously. That's not like my genius comparison. I've heard others compare that. So that might be a really cool angle. And just to clarify, like I did like the shrines and, you know, the sort of physics-based puzzles I think is really brilliant in those games. I just want something different. You know what I mean? And I'm sure Nintendo will deliver. They're smart. Yeah. They know what they're doing. They always seem to reinvent the wheel, right?
Yeah.
No pun intended. So, I want something fresh from this game. And it's still weird to me that they haven't released like a breakdown trailer, like with the VO, like this is what you're going to be doing. Yeah. They did a lot of that with that Breath of the Wild game. And it, so far, they've just released kind of cinematic gameplay trailers.
Sure.
So maybe that's, very intentional, right? Like they have a secret, right? And they don't want to. And quite frankly, maybe they don't need to. You know, maybe they're just like, it doesn't matter. You're going to buy this game. And so, cautiously optimistic, but I'm excited.
Yeah, me too. I think you nailed it. I think it's very like maybe a video will come out like a direct that'll kind of talk about it a little bit. But I think they're just so confident. They're like, it doesn't matter. It'll be fine. Like people.
And I do think they're going to stick with that date.
I hope so.
They flashed that date enough times now where I think that game is done. And I'll be shocked. But again, they've done it before, so you never know.
Yeah, it's May, right?
I think May 10th, I think. Okay. I think that's what it is.
Yeah.
Let's see. May 12th. May 12th.
Oh, May 12th. Okay, good. Yeah. Yeah, I'm excited. One thing, I still think that Elden Ring didn't get as much, and it's probably just because of my own personal dread with those games, but was the exploration that I feel like Breath of the Wild still, like, I just wanted to, like, I'd see a thing in the distance. Usually in Elden Ring, when I saw something in the distance, I was like, I'm gonna have to kill that thing. Like, you know, and in Breath of the Wild, I'm like, oh, there's something over there. I'm like, and then I'd like, see a shrine up on a mountain. I'm like, all right, how do I get up the mountain? Like, you know, so I'm very excited. I think it'll be a cool game. But yes, everyone's interested in that. Like, I don't know if there's anything else you want to touch on with this.
No, I've just, Ocarina of Time is still, I think, probably my favorite game of all time, even though I think it's borderline unplayable. It's just, but I love that franchise so much. And I have such great memories playing those games, especially on the N64. And, I think I've, even with Wind Waker, even with the, debated art style, I still love that game as well. It's a great franchise. I can't wait. I just hope they've tweaked a few things to my liking. That's my own selfish request.
Yeah.
I'm very excited.
Yeah. Yeah. Me too. But I'm kind of changing gears in a big, dark way. I want to talk about a little indie game. A few people are making it. It's called Diablo 4. I don't know.
Never heard of that.
Yeah. It's like this grim, dark fantasy thing. Isometric, play a bunch of different classes. No, obviously we're talking about one of the other massive releases for this year. A game that, Corey, there's this one YouTuber I've been watching since college, and he was covering Diablo 3. That's how long Diablo 3 is in the rearview mirror and Diablo 4 now. Like, we're talking, what, like over 10 years? Like 12, 13, 14 years? Something like that. It's crazy. So Diablo 4 is finally coming out. And as I mentioned earlier today, I'm a Gears of War guy. And one of the main guys from Gears of War left the Coalition, Rod Ferguson, to go work on Diablo because he's like, the opportunity came and I love Diablo. And that makes me excited because while a lot of people attribute the success of Gears of War to Cliff Bleszinski's ideas, which obviously Cliff was a huge, huge deal at that, Rod was also one of the main people that made that thing the way it was. And I think he understands what it's like to do action, but like gory action. So when he was moving over to Diablo, I was like, yes, like that to me was a huge win. And everything I've seen since looks like they've learned so much, not only from 3, but from 2 as well. It seems like it's this kind of, and I use this a lot, it's this chocolate and peanut butter situation where Diablo 3, a lot of people found it to be, it was very accessible, maybe too much, and you didn't have to kind of commit to any kind of build or anything with your characters. Whereas 2 was a very committed game. Like if you screwed up on skill points and stuff, it was hard to kind of come back from that for a lot of people. Whereas 4 looks like it's going to do this kind of middle ground and kind of big open world connected space. It looks amazing. I think it looks fantastic. And there's so much that they've been releasing about this game, talking about, you know, Corey, you're saying the Breath of the Wild videos. They're showing off like videos now, apparently at these like conventions and things, where they're showing off how hitboxes and like hit stop works and all of this stuff. And they're so transparent about it. And I really appreciate that, because Diablo 3 had a little bit of a rocky launch. I don't know if anybody remembers this. They had a cash shop. They had like an auction house, mm-hmm. and that kind of turned into a whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
So they're not doing that this time, even though there will be plenty of, I believe, cosmetic microtransactions. I'm still hopeful. It sounds like from the amount of stuff that is in this game, that paying that full price, you'll still really get your money's worth. And at the time of this recording, they're doing a beta if you pre-ordered. And then the weekend after, they're doing a full open beta for everybody. I'm curious to see if my rig can hold it, because my rig's a little bit older. I'm like, a friend of mine's like, are you going to play it and stream it? I'm like, I don't know if I can do both. it's like, I'll just try it out. But I'm really excited about it. I was thrilled when they finally announced the best class, in my opinion, the Necromancer. Kind of everyone thought, like, saw it coming, because they're returning to this old, darker style of Diablo 2 for this game. And all the classes look pretty cool to me. But Corey, I'm curious to know where you land on all of this, because we talked about Diablo 3 on this very show years ago, and now we're talking about Diablo 4. So where do you land?
It's funny. It's very similar to Resident Evil 4, where I've kind of almost stayed clear of it. And it's funny that you brought up like all those breakdown videos, like hitbox stuff, which is so the opposite of what Nintendo's doing with Zelda, of course. Yeah, totally. Just for clarification, Diablo 3 came out in 2012.
Thank you so much. So it's been
May 15th, I believe, is what it said. I cleared that tab, but yeah, May 15th, 2012. And now Diablo 4 is landing on June 6th, 2023. I assume that's like the official release date.
Yes. Yeah, because it's like 6/6.
Yeah. Okay. Got it. But it says initial release date March 17th. So that must be, is that today? That's today.
Yes. Yeah.
So that must today. Be the beta. Okay.
Yeah.
It's just one of those things where I just have to figure out what platform I'm going to play it on, which is to say, of course, I'm going to get this. Going back to Diablo 2, I don't think I ever played the first Diablo game. Even to this day, I don't believe I ever played the original game. Mm-hmm. But I remember getting like the war chest for Diablo 2. That was like the big physical bundle that had all the expansions, and I think I put like 200 hours into that game. Nice. Back in the day. And then of course I played Diablo 3, and yeah, that's funny. I remember that controversial live auction thing. Well, maybe it wasn't live, but it was the auction house.
Yeah.
Which I think I did use a little bit, but so Diablo 3 was kind of controversial, kind of speaking of Wind Waker, because of the art style, right? It was a little cartoony.
Yeah.
And then they, just to double down, I think they dug their heels in, like released like some Rainbow Road level too, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, their secret cow level was like unicorns.
Yeah.
Stuff. It was like right. All rainbows and stuff. And
which is faces. Really funny.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's funny to reminisce about that, because you're right, because it's a much darker take now, right? They're going back to the roots.
Yeah.
So it's hard for me to touch on like the level design, character design, because I haven't really been watching a lot of the videos. All I know is they changed that art style, and it's more of an open world design, right? You can kind of jump. You can kind of jump between platforms now.
Yeah, they have like traversal mechanics, as it were, but it's like differences in verticality, and then also there are like little cutscenes or little like kind of holes you can go through to like get to other places. But I believe it's like a fully connected world versus like, especially in Diablo 3, which was depending on the act, that's where you were geographically. Mm-hmm. Like you couldn't, you know, it wasn't like, oh, I could just go from, you know, the high mountains down to the desert. It was not that way. So
got it.
Yeah. Which I forgot too. Did you play Diablo 2 Resurrected? Did we talk about this?
I bought the Switch version because I wanted to play it handheld.
Yeah.
Which is kind of seems to be my life now. I feel like if it's on handheld, I'm going for it. Yeah, I love that game. I haven't played a lot of that Resurrected version though, but I do own a copy on Switch. So great game. Still great.
Yep.
I think they added co-op to that too, right?
They did. I played through with our mutual buddy Leo for a good chunk of it. And then we kind of fell off of it. But I went back and I was playing Necromancer, but it was like a summon build, and I went and I beat Bale. Like it was like the last thing to do. And if you do like that version, it's so hard to play by yourself. Like the whole game is easy except the bosses, because like once your little guys, your skeletons and golem die, like you're like, cool, I don't really have much to hurt you with anymore. Which one thing, I don't want to spoil too much because I want to hear about what class you might pick, but they're taking the Necromancer in some interesting ways where you can micromanage the different types of units you're making now, like with elemental effects. And also there's a version of it where it's like you summon a bunch of them and then you kill them off to give yourself like super buffs. So you can like come in as a Necromancer without any skeletons. People are like, oh, how strong is he? And you can be like really, really strong. So it's like, okay, that is like how you kill the bosses maybe. Like, it's like, okay, that's nice to know. But for you in the past, are you more of a caster? Are you more of like a melee guy? Where do you go?
Barbarian every time.
Barbarian.
Going barbarian. Yeah, okay, it looks like they are bringing that class back too.
Dude. Barbarian, but you might like the druid too. Like there's a spec where it's like you turn into werewolf and bear and all that stuff. So I don't know. That I'm glad there are folks like you out there, Cory, who love the barbarian, because that's like the last class I would pick. But sure. I love working
it's a boring with class. It's super
but I love working with one. And yeah. Well, and it's super like you get to be in it. Like you're in there just
Yeah.
You know, like that is cool. I think it's really cool.
Never gets old. Swinging the axe. Never gets old, man.
Well, and also they have to make it as complicated basically as the other classes. So they talked about like how like, you know, two-handed weapons or like all the different, like you get so many different weapons with the barbarian in this game, and they're all like apparently visually apparent on you. So like I was like, oh, that's a really cool thing. So if you have like four or five weapons, they're all gonna be like stacked up on you or on your belt and stuff.
Cool.
Like, oh, that's cool. Like that's the way cool. It ought to be. Like
so, I'll have to watch some gameplay videos. I'm a little in the dark, kind of intentionally, just because again, I know it's just one of those games I'm going to buy day one, regardless.
Yeah. Well, I'm hopeful that on Steam Deck and stuff that it'll be crossplay, because that would be really cool to team up.
Yeah. Looks like I got a few months to figure it out. I didn't realize that was a June release. I thought it was sooner than that, but I guess that makes sense if they're doing the beta now, then that gives them a few months to have feedback to fix whatever they need to fix. So, yeah, man, I love Diablo 2 and 3. They're both great. And you brought up Rod Ferguson, which is interesting. I'll be curious on what his specific kind of contribution will be. Is he like a general manager there at Blizzard now? Or
I'm trying to remember if he's like creative director or something, because he went into one of the bigger roles there. And I was curious because, yeah, you're right. Like, you think they have like that full team ready to go. But I think he was pulled for being one of the people who continued to spearhead Gears after Cliff left, because he was like the guy you saw in all the like the production videos. He'd be like, hi, like I'm here. We're doing, you know, Gears 4 or 5 or whatever. But yeah, it's sad to lose him from Gears. Oh. But no, let's continue.
Oh, sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt you. I was just going to say the only last thing I would say to your question about if it'll run is, Blizzard's always been so great at, you know, optimizing even with older machines and video cards. So I think that's baked into their development, is they just want to make sure this thing runs on as many, you know, pieces of hardware as possible. So that would be the last thing that I would say, is I would expect this to be optimized, but I don't know for sure.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, they got Diablo 3 up and running on the Switch, which I'm sure was no easy thing to do. So, and let's see, I was just going to list off what they have. So they have listed PS5, Xbox One.
Oh, wow.
PS, Yeah, PS4, Series X, Series S, and Microsoft Windows. They don't have Steam listed, but we'll see. So I don't know. So, anyways.
Yeah, and I played through Diablo 2 Resurrected actually on my Series X, so it is possible.
Yeah.
It's just that, like, since 2, when 3 came out, there were so many more spells, and I think they did a pretty good job of doing it on controller, but I still personally prefer mouse and keyboard. It's like playing an RTS or something. Yeah. Like, you can do it on controller. It's just not the best.
So,
for me anyway. So, yeah. So, I'm looking forward to it. I think I'll get it no matter what, just because it's one of those games that I think will be really enjoyable. But I'm the kind of guy, Corey, that, like, I'll play through the campaign a few times with, like, different characters, and then I'm like, I'm pretty good. I'm not one of those guys who's like, I will be there every season, and I will make my character like this unstoppable killing machine, and I like I'm on the super nightmare difficulties. Like, that's usually not me. Yeah. I would do it if I had a group who was committed to it. That's where it is for me. I don't know about you.
Yeah, and Diablo 3 was the game that got me to finally stop paying for World of Warcraft. Wow. Yeah, because when that came out, it was such a big deal to have another co-op Blizzard game with loot involved that you could play with a buddy. And I remember when that came out, I had a friend that we both dropped WoW like a bad habit. And then I stuck with Diablo. He went back to Warcraft. And I never went. Because it was, God, what was the expansion at the time? You brought up the werewolf. Was it like war? What was that werewolf themed?
All the Worgen and stuff.
Worgen, yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes. So that was not a druid. That was a different class in the Warcraft universe.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Got it.
Yep.
Yeah, I think that's my thoughts on Diablo 4. I've been in that franchise since 2, right? So a long time. And I don't plan on stopping now. I can't wait.
Yeah, me neither. I'm very excited about it. And I'm curious to see how it runs on old Nightshade here. That's the name of my PC.
So yeah,
hopefully Nightshade, you can take it.
Hopefully they did enough optimizing so you can tweak some sliders, right?
I'm gonna turn the shadows off. Shadows or textures might be coming down a little bit. Like, you know, no offense, as long as it runs well, because like 3 ran really well, and it is very arcadey, but man, I just loved running through with my wizard or whatever and just using my like disintegrate beam. I'm like,
so
no detail left.
The question is with the acquisition of Blizzard Activision, is that going to be on Game Pass in June? Probably too soon.
I think it's still too soon. Okay. I think last I had heard about acquisition for that was like this summer. Everything was going to be totally done and dusted. However, that being said, I think once that's done and once, you know, it's all really like the ink is dry, then this will come to Game Pass. Like, this is a perfect Game Pass game. And you know what? What were you going to say?
Oh, I'm sorry. Continue. Nope.
Oh, no. I was going to say, you know, some people might be like, well, Jimmy, this is like a AAA thing. Why would they put on Game Pass? Like, they're putting, if it's any first party Microsoft thing now, it's really like it's going right to Game Pass. So I think it'll come there.
Yep. The only thing I was going to say, do you think they'll dissolve Battle.net? Do you think that they'll keep that brand, or do you think they'll do just some Microsoft Studios thing?
Wasn't there something about Battle.net kind of recently where they were like, it was something about when they fused it in with like all the EA stuff. And I feel like if it survived all of that, I think Battle.net will still stick around.
Sure.
Just because they'd have to integrate it into some sort of brand new Microsoft thing.
Kind of like Disney keeping Lucasfilm or something. It could be a nostalgic thing. It could be, you know, okay.
That's cool. What I think anyway. And then also, like, you get a lot of people who are still playing all the time who would be really nervous about a transition. And then, like, I can already see, like, the mounts that were inadvertently deleted on World of Warcraft and people getting really angry about that. Be like, sorry. So, yeah. I think they'll keep it. I think we'll keep Battle.net, probably. Okay. But or integrate it somehow into... We might see that pop up on the Xbox, like, user interface, like, on, like... I don't know. Maybe you could see that you pop it open. It's like, oh yeah, log into your Battle.net account. Because you had to do that for Overwatch.
Mm-hmm.
So I wonder, I don't know.
It's tough to say.
But yeah, either way, Diablo 4, I saw a video again recently where they're talking about like the detail, like so much little details. The thing that I'm most excited about, Corey, is when you kill an enemy in a certain way with a certain spell or whatever, they'll probably die that way. Like if it's on fire, they get turned to ash. You know, if it's lightning, they, you know, sizzle like that. That kind of stuff.
speechless. That's cool.
They had a little bit of that in 3, but more is better.
Taking it to the next level.
Take more. I need more. Mm-hmm. But yeah, that's kind of my other really big last game that I'm looking forward to for this year. Are there any others that pop up to you that you would like to talk about?
Yeah, I mean, I can just mention a couple that we, you know, probably don't need a lot of discussion. I'm curious about Starfield, of course. It's not high on my list. Otherwise, I would have mentioned it more in a more deep fashion. But I love those Bethesda Game Studios games. Even with their faults, right? But Oblivion, Skyrim, the Fallout franchise, of course. So taking that to space now. I know they had a new date, right? September now. So that's coming up September. And it was funny to me, they're having a Bethesda Direct. They're just literally stealing that word from Nintendo, which makes me laugh. They're doing a Starfield Direct. This summer, yeah. Star Wars Jedi Survivor, kind of meh. I mean, yeah, we'll see.
I'm curious.
We'll see how that goes. And then Assassin's Creed Mirage. I like what they had to say about that initially. So, going back to the roots.
I think I'm getting too overexcited about it, Corey, because we've only seen like a cinematic trailer for this, but like, if you could take what Assassin's Creed 1 or 2 kind of did and update it and, you know, modernize some of the movement and stuff and bring it back to the basics, like you said, that to me is so exciting because as much as I love Assassin's Creed 4 Black Flag, it really might be my favorite Assassin's Creed game.
It's really good.
The Assassin stuff is so on the back burner, and I feel like that was when it started to kind of deviate in a bigger way. And then when we kind of had not a soft reboot, but a kind of reimagining with Origins and Odyssey and Ragnarok, it was we're not really assassins anymore. It's I'm a Viking and I kind of assassinate people, but not really. Yeah. This to me feels like back to the roots, and it's very exciting because it's and that first game came out in 2007, if I'm not mistaken.
Crazy.
Crazy. I'm excited for that, man. And I this guy, it's Basim, from Ragnarok. And I was that's cool. That's a nice through line for people who played that.
Yeah.
But yeah, I can't wait to see that game. Cause I keep forgetting about this, Corey, even though games like that and Monster Hunter World 2, we don't have official dates. Sometimes E3 would come around or whatever, and they'd be it's coming out in 3 months, or it's coming out in October or November or whatever. So I think Mirage will hopefully be this year. Plus they have 5 other Assassin's Creed games or whatever, in the works. So I just want to see this one, and I want it to be glorious because also that's how I got my history lessons. You know what I mean? Right. I got them in school too, but I learned a lot about Italy through the Assassin's Creed games specifically. I learned a lot. So I'm excited to learn more about that world in the past.
Totally.
So, I'm there for it, man. Probably day and date.
Yep.
Let's go.
Yeah, me too. I think they actively said this is not a loot game too. I think, correct me if I'm wrong, but they're just back to basics. It's going to have a focus, right? Rather than this kind of jack of all trades, open world, big RPG, this is more of a focused, tight Assassin's Creed experience. So that's really exciting to me.
Yeah.
So yeah, man, that, there's a lot of other games on my screen in front of me. I don't think anything, strikes me. Are you excited for Redfall? Perhaps
I'm interested in Redfall. So here's the deal. I had Game Pass. I've kind of put it on hold for now, but I might get it back depending. Again, that one seems so dependent for me personally on playing with friends. You can play it completely alone, but that'll be a Game Pass game. And it's people at first, and I thought this too, is it kind of a Left 4 Dead? And it's not. I've heard the big thing now is more of a comparison to Far Cry 2 specifically. So, and it's such a cool, interesting world that they've built. And again, I am interested, but I gotta have buds to play with. Otherwise, I would be cool, I bought some vampires and I'm done. Yeah.
Same.
Yeah.
I feel the only other game I need to bring up in slightly a negative light, unfortunately, was the kind of sloppy and delayed Suicide Squad showing. Suicide Squad, Kill the Justice League.
They
kind of pulled the curtain back on a little bit further than they have previously. And people seem really unhappy with that game. And the only thing I will say is I recently have been replaying Arkham City Game of the Year Edition on my Steam Deck because I just came across a video on how well that game runs on the Steam Deck. Cool. You know, 60 frames.
Wow.
Looks great. And man, that game is so good and it still holds up really well. And I'm just having so much fun playing that. And then to switch sides and see what's happening with I should confirm it's a Rocksteady Games.
Yeah.
And from my point of view, it's kind of a bummer, but I'll reserve complete judgment until I can play it. How are you feeling on the Suicide Squad game?
I trust Rocksteady, and I have for a while. They're like one of the few developers after a lot of the shakeups that I was like, okay, they consistently make still really good games.
Yep.
After seeing this stuff, the footage of this kind of, for lack of a better term, Fortnite-ian style, where it's like all of these characters are jumping around and shooting like crazy.
Shooting purple things.
Yeah, I'm like
purple targets. Yeah,
I'm like, I'm a little nervous. and again, like I like the Suicide Squad in general. It's just such an interesting direction to take them in.
Mm-hmm.
And I hope it feels good. When I was watching, like they were showing it, like, you know, especially with Deadshot, I feel like with him specifically, you have to make the sniping feel incredible. And it's hard to tell from a video. So if the feel is there, I'm excited. But I'm nervous about it. I think that the story will be really cool. I think it'll be really cool no matter what. But I'm nervous about the implementation. And bringing up Arkham City, there's a game where 40% of it or whatever, it's some sort of percentage, it's in the Batmobile. And the Batmobile does feel good. It does legitimately feel good. But it was kind of like this design choice that Rocksteady went all in on. And I can respect that. But what I can't respect, Corey, is how they did my buddy Deathstroke a disservice. And I will never forget it, Rocksteady. You need to redeem him. Let me play him in this game and I will give it a 10 out of 10. All right, that's how it works. Like, let me play as Deathstroke. I want to play Deathstroke. Anyway, so I don't know. We'll see about this. Yeah. Also, I think the boss battles will be what this game lives and dies on, because if you're fighting against the Justice League, they have to be good and they have to kind of make sense, which is hard because the four characters you're playing as would really probably not stand up to most of these characters for more than like 5 or 10 seconds, like especially the Flash. I'm like, so I don't know.
Yeah, man. There's a phrase, right? It's a cliche phrase, but it's, you know, strike while the iron is hot, right? And I feel like they're aiming that at the games of service genre. And in my opinion, if you look at the track record of that genre, it's not good. You know, time and time again, you know, BioWare did it with Anthem and it failed fairly miserably. And I, you know, you got Gotham Knights. I don't know if that classifies as a games of service.
Kind of.
But then, of course, you have Square Enix, Crystal Dynamics Avengers, which didn't turn out so well. Quite frankly, in that genre, the only one that I can think of was Destiny that was kind of successful. Maybe I'm sure there are others that did well. And I'm sure Rocksteady has access to numbers that say otherwise. But I don't know. I'm not excited for this at all. That's just me, you know.
I appreciate the candor.
Yeah, if it comes out and it's great, great. That's great. Yeah. Then I'll dive in. I'll play as what's the shark character, whatever.
Oh yeah, King Shark. Yeah, he looks cool, right?
It just looks very silly and fun. But it's not. You know, traditionally, it's not the game that I would generally be excited for from a Rocksteady studio. I think that wraps up my list. I don't know if you had anything else.
I just want to say a few things about you. You said some great stuff there. I want to stand by this Anthem. I feel bad because that's a good game.
Yep.
I will say its hub was not wonderful, but like the gameplay itself, if they could have come out, like, I feel like 2 years later,
mm-hmm.
it's kind of, or like Evolve, Evolve would have been a perfect, again, one of those types of games as a service thing. But Anthem still had some of the best combat and gameplay in any of these. And it's interesting you bring up Marvel's Avengers too, because I didn't think about this until someone said it recently. There are big player bases for these games, right? And Marvel's Avengers recently announced that they will no longer be continuing to make new stuff for the game or to support it in that way. So that's a player base that could migrate. And they probably have migrated to Avengers in the first place, and then they might migrate over to, you know, Suicide Squad.
Good point.
Who knows if they're going to stay there, but like, and maybe they're the people who went and tried, you know, Gotham Knights, but that was like, the longevity wasn't there. Maybe this game will have that. And we know they're doing a battle pass. We know they're doing, you know, all this stuff. So they're in it for the long haul. I'm just interested to see a studio with the caliber of Rocksteady attempt to do this and maybe learn from the mistakes that others have made and make a really good game. That's my hope anyway.
Yeah.
But I am nervous just because for me, I'm just like, I would rather have you just made Batman Beyond. That's what I want instead of this or the Wonder Woman game or whatever else. Like,
Give me a strong single player game with a co-op option.
Yes. Yeah. That would be great. And especially after playing Gotham Knights, which I did, and I liked it, but I was not as crazy about it. It's just like, I'm hopeful for this game, but I'm also nervous. So, and also if like they said, we're coming out with new characters and stuff, then maybe there'd be more of like, this could be like, you got to check back in on this game. But right now I'm like, we'll see.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah, and not to make it super negative, I mean, you do have some positive stuff happening. Like, they did delay it, so they're clearly aware of the reception and the state of that game. And then you have Kevin Conroy's last performance as Batman. Conroy, did I say that right? I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Kevin Conroy, okay. So Batman is in this game in some form with Kevin's voice, so... I just not hot for me on this one, but some light at the end of the tunnel, right?
Yeah.
Not a complete dark scenario.
I'm hoping that like, and they probably won't do this, Corey, but like, what if they had in the very beginning of this game, more than the four on that Suicide Squad, there's like five or six, and you get like, kind of like from the movie, there's that Slipknot guy who like sneaks away and gets killed. What if they have that and we saw Batman make a kill on one of them, because he's all like brainiac out. Like, that would be amazing.
That would be cool.
Like, like that's the kind of stuff I'm looking for in the story here. Like, that's, I need it.
Yeah.
I need it, Corey.
But so personally, I wish it was flipped around. I just wish it was a Justice League game. And that's no joke. It's just, you know, and maybe those characters are too powerful. I don't know.
You can do it. Like, imagine, like, it's like you're playing Superman, I'm in the Batwing flying, or like
Green Lantern, Wonder Woman, Flash. I know.
Like Aquaman, like that'd be incredible. I completely agree. And maybe that's the idea, is if they have the like the models and the everything for it, that they could actually, you know, bring those characters. Like, maybe that'll be the thing, like in a year after it launches, like, and now you can play as Superman or something. It could be like okay.
So now it's just a platform for DC characters moving forward.
I'd be fine with that.
That'd be cool.
Totally fine with that. Like,
that'd be cool.
Everyone would be like, wait a sec. Wait, what did you just say? They'd be like, I get to do what now? I get to play who?
Yeah.
Like,
No matter how hard you try, those Suicide Squad, you know, they're always going to be B-minus characters. Like, no matter how hard you try.
Yeah. No question about it. No question. That's why it's like, it's always amazing to me that like Harley Quinn or like Captain Boomerang could survive any amount of time with any of these characters. Is like, oh, he's got a boomerang, she's got a baseball bat, like, and it's like, it's Superman. I'm like, how long is this gonna last? Like, is it kryptonite? Do you guys all have kryptonite? You better,
right?
So and Suicide Squad is just kind of a thing. Like, it just seems to, in the media, it's kind of like DC's Deadpool-y stuff. So I don't know, it's just been a long time coming. And I'm hopeful for this game. I'm really hopeful. Yeah. So just add, Rocksteady, I know you're watching. Just add the Justice League and Deathstroke, and we're gonna be totally fine. Like, we'll be so happy. That should be good. like one day. Should probably be able to put that on there. But those are the games we're looking forward to. If you're watching this, by the way, on YouTube, please let us know in the comments, like, which games you're looking forward to, because I would be curious to hear if there's some that we missed that you're like, oh, why didn't you talk about this game?
Yeah.
Yeah, because we could go on and on.
We're going to get all the Street Fighter 6 fans. They're going to be all upset.
The Street Fighter 6, man, I've seen the physics, like the thigh jiggles and stuff like that. That's, it's a big deal for Street Fighter 6, I guess. I don't know. Yeah. Very funny. But yeah, I do want to talk about a few games we've been playing recently. And there's a surprise I have for Corey. I told him at the beginning of the show, before we even started, I should say. And I want to talk to you about a game that I have not purchased, but I was playing on Game Pass, and that you've talked about. I want to talk about Vampire Survivors.
Ooh, all right. Now we're talking.
Dude.
Now, we should have started the show with this.
I know, but I was like, I don't know. Okay, so it's $5.
Yep.
At full price.
Yeah.
It was like, when I had Game Pass, which I kind of stopped for a bit, it was like $4, and I was like, I should have bought it. But me, I'm nervous to buy it, Corey. You know why? Because like the first time I played it, and it's a roguelite.
Yeah.
So you're playing as like these 8 or 16 bit characters. They're all kind of like based loosely kind of on like Castlevania characters. They all have like, they all come with their first little power, but then you can amass different powers and stuff. And you're supposed to just basically survive for like a half hour or something. And the big trick about this game is you basically just move your character and it auto attacks, like depending on what spells you have or in an area of effect. But the more stuff you get, the crazier it becomes and so on and so forth. So if anybody's played like Risk of Rain or Dead Cells or stuff like that, it's kind of that vibe. My fear though, Corey, is like I played the first level and I was like, that's fine. And then I played a few more and there was one, Corey, the second level is in this library.
Yeah.
And I was playing as this mage. She's like casting like little spells.
Is it the blue wand? The blue wand?
Yeah, the blue wand.
Yep.
I got down to like no health and I had the little like, one of the items I picked up was like this invulnerability shield that kept coming back. And I was like, there's no way I'm going to survive for very long. And Corey, I got to 29 minutes and like 30 seconds or something like that. It got insane. And I was like, oh my gosh. And I loved it. And I'm like, I was like, I'm kind of addicted. And I was like, I don't know if I should buy it because I'm afraid. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I was like, I'll just do like one more. It's like Hades. So I'm like, I'll just do one more. And it's like, So what do you think?
I want to. It creeps in, man. It creeps in. I know. Yeah. It's like Marvel Snap. It's just like, I'm going to just do one more. And then I'm going to bed, I swear. Just one more. Yeah. So are you playing on a TV, just to clarify?
I'm playing on a TV 4:3 aspect ratio.
Got it. Nice. Okay. See, I'm playing Steam Deck. So it's more of like, I'm just kind of picking it up here and there and I'll set it down. I'll pick it back up, play it here and more. Initially I didn't get the thrill of it. I didn't see the hype. I didn't understand it. I'm like, this is really boring. It's just a single stick, very simple gimmick, right? And then like you, I think I got to that I think it hit me before I even hit that second stage. I think I had the revelation in that first stage. I'm like, oh, there's something here. And it's now I think I've unlocked 4 or 5 stages and the majority of the characters and I'm hooked. It's just a great pickup and set down game that I've just been playing over the past month or two. And I love it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I'm thinking about picking it up. Do you think I should? Like I said, I loved it. And then my Game Pass ran out and I was like,
it's $5. I mean,
it's $5.
Teenagers spend more than that on a Starbucks at Target. Like,
it's totally true. You're right.
Especially in California, man. What is your lattes out there? $12.95, like, something like that.
Yeah, at least I think, and that's before tax. But one thing I wish they would add, even though it might break the game, like a co-op would be so weird in this game. Would it be too much? Would it be too much? I don't know.
Yeah, it might break the flow. I think they could get away with it with like a dedicated stage scenario maybe for co-op. Yeah, I don't see why not.
Okay, so here's my question for you. I have unlocked like 5 or 6 characters so far. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't like, it does matter at the beginning, but then depending on what you pick up and what you choose after you gain your levels, that's kind of where you can kind of make your build, as it were. Mm-hmm. Which character do you typically like to start with?
So the one that I have now that I've been using a lot is like a monk character that has the garlic. So, his starter thing is the little garlic force field, because you're going to pick up the projectiles. You know what I mean? You're going to pick up the potions. You're going to pick up the wands. So it's nice to just start with that garlic. But I don't really have a particular favorite. I think the one that I like the least is the one that has the lightning starter. Yeah, I didn't really connect with that character. I'm sorry, I don't know all the names off the top of my head.
That's fine.
But what was a really fun dynamic for me was the transition from that first to second stage, because there's a floor and a ceiling of that second stage, right? So where that first stage, you can go in any direction, which seems like endless, right? Until all the skeletons swarm in and then you have no choice or no chance. But that second stage was like, okay, they're changing it up. There's a floor and a ceiling, so you're limited a little bit. So that's partially where my hook came to. So yeah, it's just something I play every night, a little bit here and there, and I'm addicted and I love it. So
yes, I might pick it up. That's why I'm just afraid. I'm afraid, man, because I've seen videos and I love the idea of not like your character just standing there and everything's dying around you and you're just standing like, kind of quietly
doing nothing.
And I had that happen and I was like, oh, I'm gonna make it, and they still somehow got through and I'm like, damn. But I was like, okay, that's okay, because like you just upgrade, you get your coins and stuff, and then like the little treasures you find and the little like it feels very dopamine rush.
Mm-hmm.
Because you get these little treasures that open, and then you get like one item, maybe three items, maybe five items, and all this gold. And I'm like, okay, this is made by one guy, and he's asking $5 for it.
Yep. It's worth it.
It's worth it. It's like, it's worth and it. Apparently, it spawned a bunch of other games too. So it's like, oh, this is clearly like its own little genre thing that's happening or building up on other games. So yeah, it's just cool. I've heard just like, people say like it's like bullet hell, but you are the bullet hell, like,
right?
You know,
yeah. I don't think there's been an official genre name yet, like Metroidvania, or you know, those genres that have come along. But it's a simple game, but they managed to find ways to make it really fun and addicting. And $5, man, it's worth it.
And talk about accessibility, like, because other big games have been trying to go for this for a long time and they made great strides in it. This is a game that you can literally play with one finger or a thumb, basically, and just, you know, or like you have to hit another button in between and win the treasures or whatever. Like, that's insane to me that like someone figured that out. Like,
yeah, it's funny because the Steam Deck is not particularly light. And so there's been times where like I've been playing so long that my arms get tired. I'll just set it down and then just one finger my way through those environments. You know what I mean?
You're like, yeah, sometimes I love sometimes you have to like, tank the hit to get out of a situation. Yeah. You're like, I'm going to take some damage, but I'm going to.
If it's not on Switch, it should be, because then you could just connect the one Joy-Con and then just kind of rest it in your lap and then just watch the mayhem unfold.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
Brilliant, Corey. Brilliant. I love that.
I'm super happy that you picked it up.
Yes. Well, it's one of those games that like I've heard people, like they hop online with their friends and they're both playing. They're not playing together, but they're just playing. They're just like, oh, what did you get? You'd be like, oh, I got this. Like, oh my gosh, it's getting crazy. Like, oh, I want to do that with you. I'd be like, Corey, I'm playing right now. And you'd be like, yeah, dude, I know.
It'd probably be a really fun game to stream too. I don't really stream games, but.
Yeah, I was thinking about that because I've seen other people do it. And I was like, yeah, and every time is different. And it's just one of those things that, you know, people have their ideas and, you know, you watch it and you'd be like, oh, he barely survived that. Or be like, oh, I died. We'll just start again. Like, it's not that big a deal. So. Yeah, so that's the one thing I wanted to bring up today for sure to tell you, because it's like I've been playing this and I wanted to mention it.
Makes me happy. So yeah.
Good. Dude, yeah. Vampire Survivors. Check it out, everybody. Mm-hmm. And they also have like DLC for it. I don't know what that DLC is per se. It's some characters or something. So
same. I haven't explored it. I just playing the base game.
Playing the base game. That's okay. But yeah, well, Corey, I wish we could do this all day. Just take over QCTV and just talk about video games. But we have to limit ourselves. But I appreciate you being here and chatting about all these games we're excited about and a little Vampire
Likewise.
Survivors here at the end. Always
thank you, Jimmy.
It. Yeah. And thank you to QCTV for letting us continue to do this. And thank you, dear viewers, for watching. We hope you enjoy it. And like I said before, if you are watching on YouTube, please let us know down in the comments what you're excited about, or maybe what you're chumming the waters with playing right now. You know what I mean? But until next time, take care. Bye-bye.